Hey guys, it's Michelle, and today I'm going to be giving you 6 reasons why I dropped out of NYU. Full disclosure up front, I did not drop out of college, I just dropped out of NYU specifically.
During my first semester, I was really unhappy with quite a lot of things at the university, and more than a few of these issues I would have ran into, and it probably would have been worse at a different university as well. So eventually when I found the new crazy online startup school called Minerva College that I will be going to this fall, I was very, very excited. That being said, I did technically drop out of NYU.
There are a lot of reasons why I wanted to leave NYU when I was there and why I decided not to do a second semester. Reason number one being price. I was always highly uncomfortable with that huge price tag. And of course I was aware of it when I applied to the school, but back then, which was 2 years ago, I thought that it was worth it paying that much for a higher education. Not only did I see New York City as full of opportunities, but I saw NYU as a really great link between me and a lot of those connections and jobs and internships I wouldn't be able to access without a prestigious university. But after spending a year living in the real world, realizing what I valued, I saw that I gave a rat's ass about security and about prestige in terms of what I did with my life. I really just cared about my contentment, and that's pretty much it. And I don't need to spend $70,000, $75,000 a year to get that. Reason number two why I dropped out. The entire university life experience, if I'm gonna be honest with you, often felt like a big adult daycare or summer camp. There were always activities like let's go ice skating or paint pumpkins together, which is really cute and great and all, but in the end, the shitload of money that I'm paying for this school, some of it is going towards that. And if I don't need it, and if I don't participate in those events, then I'm kind of wasting my money. The United States is the most expensive country to go to university in the entire world, and this summer campy vibe is why. If you don't have all these grand activities and shows and NYU pride events to fund, then you don't have school spirit and US university life. Reason number three, when NYU didn't feel like a daycare, it felt like a big corporation that was trying to milk my wallet dry. First of all, I was forced to have a meal plan. I understand all freshmen need to have a meal plan because most of them are coming from their parents' house, blah, 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 don't know how to feed themselves, I get it. But it just made absolutely no sense because it's very expensive to have one. And I lived right next to a grocery store and prefer and know how to cook for myself. Also, sometimes those swipes really are not a good deal. I think each one is worth like $8 maybe. The first time I went to an NYU dining hall, I got a very simple avocado roll or some sushi like that, and like a small cup of chopped pineapple. When I went to go check out, the lady was like, oh yeah, that's 2 swipes. I was like, what? You're gonna charge me the equivalent of $16 for some shitty supermarket sushi and a cup of chopped pineapples that's probably been sitting there for 2 days? The other thing that kind of pissed me off was the deal with the class readings. So I took mainly seminar classes, which means that my assigned readings were books, not textbooks. But when the professors assigned them, they would still always say, you can find these books at the NYU bookstore. And when I asked them, oh, could I find it in the library maybe? They looked at me kind of weird, like they had never been asked that before. When I went to BOPST, I understood why they were so confused. It's because 8 times out of 10 when I went looking for these class books, they did not exist in the library, or they were checked out for the next like 5 months. BOPST does not go out of its way to make available books that you actually need. And why would they? Because in the end, if they don't make it available, you're forced to go to the NYU bookstore and pay money to rent the books or buy them. Reason number four. This is where it gets a bit controversial. I found NYU to be very fake progressive and also quite close-minded. So first off, in terms of NYU's fake progressivism, what I mean by this is the institution only stands by its progressive values when it's convenient and beneficial for them to do so. So for example, Andrew Hamilton, the president of NYU, spent a good 10 minutes during the presidential welcome talking about
how this was NYU's most diverse freshman class so far, how there's like 20% black, or 18% Hispanic, whatever, you know, giving all these stats about all the black and brown kids he got in his class.
So that's what you have on the surface, right? Behind closed doors, NYU contracts its dining services out to a company that profits off the very racist, exploitative prison industrial complex system.
The phrase prison industrial complex system refers to the criminal justice system we have in the US, which profits off of incarcerating people, specifically and largely disproportionately Black and Brown people.
So you have NYU talking about how it cares about diversity, but at the same time supporting a highly racist system. Speaking of that specific hypocrisy, there was a student group that actually protested this. The Incarceration to Education Coalition sat on the Kimmel steps as a sit-in protest. And what did NYU do? They threatened to suspend these kids. And this is the same exact institution that said in 2018,
"Oh, we support any applicants that were suspended over protesting gun violence by doing the school walkout."
And then they turn around and threaten to suspend their own students. It's like, dude, bad look. As for NYU being closed-mindedly liberal, I just feel like NYU is always acting like it's this open-minded, inclusive, diverse place, when really I don't think it is. I was actually surprised about how racially diverse it was when I first got there, and at how many people weren't, you know, like these rich kids I thought they were gonna be. But in terms of diversity of opinions, not so hot. I get it, somebody very conservative wouldn't want to apply to NYU, it totally makes sense. But at the same time, people who aren't extremely, extremely liberal are actually scared to voice their opinions. And they won't say what they're actually thinking during classes because they're scared that people, including the professor, are going to completely shut them down. Not even just conservative, because the school is pretty international. Sometimes people have opinions that are not formed by the US notions of liberal or conservative.
And you can't even put them on the spectrum. And where they're coming from has nothing to do with the US because they're coming from a different country that has a different history. Therefore, their political views are informed by a completely different context.
This is an issue not just in NYU, but in colleges and universities across the United States especially. With the political environment we have going on, it's inevitable that it's like this. But it doesn't mean that it's right. And I like getting my opinions validated and encouraged as much as the next person, but in the end that does not help you strengthen your argument or critically think. Take this coming from somebody who grew up in a school district that was actually pretty politically divided.
After the 2016 election, half the students came in wearing Make America Great Again hats and the other half came in sobbing. I literally had to scream with tears streaming down my face at my politics and government teacher during my senior year about why people were so upset over Trump.
So trust me, I understand what the flip side of being in a bubble is. And as much as I love being surrounded by people who are like-minded, there's a difference between like-minded and like-opinioned, you know? And there's also a difference between being critical of somebody and completely shutting them down and being closed-minded. Reason number 5. I looked at the trajectory that I was on going through NYU, thought about the different possibilities of what it would probably look like when I was graduating in 3 to 4 years, and those possibilities really did not excite me. I couldn't envision anything but still staying in New York, which is cool, but scrambling to find some 9-to-5 job so I could pay my own bills. It seemed to be, you know, working for an old system and just being a cog. It didn't really seem revolutionary. And maybe I'm too naive and my expectations are too high, but in the end, I had a way of getting out, so I did.
And I'm telling you, I was so, so happy when I found out that I could drop out. When I opened up the admissions decision from Minerva, I started crying.
It was everything I wanted that everybody told me was too ideal. It wasn't possible, but yet it exists in this school that I got into. It was just, never settle for mediocrity and think of yourself as too ideal if you haven't tried to reach for that ideal already. Number 6. This is the most important out of all the reasons. I was not happy at NYU. I loved the academics of the school. I think Gallatin is so cool and my classes were really, really interesting and I was doing well and getting good grades. I also had really good friends both in and outside of NYU. I absolutely loved New York City, but in the end none of that mattered because I still had this gut feeling that I wasn't where I was supposed to be. Your gut knows when you're on the right path. It knows when it feels like you have a purpose being there. Do not ignore that feeling if something is off because it's your gut telling you that you're not in the right place. Of course, every job, every school is gonna have its flaws, its aspects that you don't like. But in the end, if you feel like you have a higher purpose that aligns with that job or school, then it makes those things worth it. I do want to say that after trashing NYU for however long this video was, I still am really, really grateful I went for a semester and actually learned a lot from my experience there. I met a lot of great friends that I know I'll stay in contact with, and my classes actually taught me a lot of new perspectives and information that I didn't know before, which was really cool. And I also fell in love with the arts again because NYU is so, so wonderfully creative. So even though my one semester run at NYU did have its good and bad aspects, all things have its expiration date, and that expiration date just happened to not be my graduation date. It's like a bad relationship. Know when you need to break it off, know what was wrong, but you know, no hard feelings. I hope you guys like this video. Don't forget to subscribe, to comment, and to like, and to maybe share it with somebody who you think would find it interesting. Thanks so much for watching. I will see you guys next video.